Good morning. We're so glad that you chose to join us this morning. If you're joining us for the first time, please text the word hello to the number on your screen. That just gives us a way to connect with you a little further. We're looking forward to worshiping together this morning, so we would encourage you to just sing along with us as we worship.
You are here, working in this place. miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Cause you are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are. God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle work, promise keep, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Lord, that is who you are. We just thank you so much for being so benevolent and so giving and so helpful towards us. We just thank you so much for who you are. We just thank you for your Son who came down to this earth to die on the cross for us. And we just pray that as we enter this time of communion, that our hearts can be focused on you and that we can remember that the body of your Son was broken on the cross for our sins. His blood was poured out in order to cleanse us from all of our failures and wrongdoings. So we just once again thank you for who you are, our waymaker, our God, and our Savior. It's in your Son's name we pray. Amen.
When Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." The Pharisees challenged him, "Here you are, appearing as your own witness. Your testimony is not valid." Jesus answered, "Even if I testify on my own behalf, my testimony is valid. For I know where I came from and where I am going. But you have no idea where I come from or where I am going. You judge by human standards. I pass judgment on no one. But if I do judge, my decisions are true, because I am not alone. I stand with the Father who sent me." In your own law, it is written that the testimony of two witnesses is true. I am one who testifies for myself. My other witness is the Father who sent me. Then they asked him, "Where is your Father?" "You do not know me or my Father," Jesus replied. "If you knew me, you would know my Father also. He spoke these words while teaching in the temple courts, near the place where the offerings were put. Yet no one seized him, because his hour had not yet come. Once more, Jesus said to them, I am going away, and you will look for me, and you will die in your sin. Where I go, you cannot come. This made the Jews ask, will he kill himself? Is that why he says, where I go, you cannot come? But he continued, you are from below, I am from above. You are of this world, I am not of this world. I told you that you would die in your sins. If you do not believe that I am he, you will indeed die in your sins. Who are you? They asked. Just what I have been telling you from the beginning, Jesus replied. I have much to say in judgment of you, but he who sent me is trustworthy, and what I have heard from him, I tell the world. They did not understand that he was telling them about his father. So Jesus said, when you have lifted up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am he, and that I do nothing on my own but speak just what the Father has taught me. The one who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, for I always do what pleases him. Even as he spoke, many believed in him.
I want to welcome you to our online service, and this is another week in our sermon series called I Am Exactly What You Need. And really what this whole series is about is Jesus' famous I Am statements from John's Gospel, where he just really describes himself in ways that meets our needs. And a lot of times we think we know what we need, but we can get that wrong, and that's why it's so important to understand why Jesus is saying what he's saying in the way that he describes himself. And so, you know, today we're going to focus on another one of those I Am statements where Jesus calls himself the light of the world. And, you know, if you think about light, light changes things. Whenever light hits something, it just changes the look. It can change the color. So, you know, light is an influencer. Light brings clarity. And so one of the things that we're really going to see is really how the light of Christ makes us aware of what our real needs are in our lives. So there's a way that Jesus was described as John's Gospel opens. In the very first chapter, I want to read this. This is John chapter 1, verses 9 and 10. It says, the one who is the true light, who gives light to everyone, was coming into the world, and he came into the very world he created, but the world didn't recognize him. I mean, can you imagine? This is making this big announcement that Jesus is coming into the world, but the very world that he created looked at him and didn't recognize who he was, didn't recognize why he came, and really just kind of looked at him and says, no, we really don't need you. And primarily the ones that rejected Jesus, rejected his teachings, was the religious leaders during that time. They didn't like his teachings. They didn't like his claims about himself. And one of the things they really didn't like was how he treated people who stepped outside of God's law. And you know, at that point, we're talking about the law of God that was given through Moses. And there were like over 700, but it probably seems like there were over 7,000 different laws. And when Jesus would interact with someone that maybe had stepped outside of the law, there was this expectation that depending on what the offense was, you know, maybe that person might deserve to be condemned in the least, but maybe even stoned to death on some occasions. And so we're going to look at one of these examples because really it kind of forms the context for this first I Am statement. It's found in John chapter 8, verses 3 through 5. As he was speaking, the teachers of the religious law and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in the act of adultery. And they put her in front of the crowd. Teacher, they said to Jesus, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. And the law of Moses says to stone her, what do you say? So you have this woman, and they bring her in. They just kind of, you know, throw her down maybe before Jesus. And it's a trap. I mean, what they are really hoping is that he's going to say something that's going to make himself look bad or get himself in trouble with the religious leaders. And they know that, you know, what the law says is because of the kind of lifestyle that she's living or what she's just been caught doing, that she deserves to be condemned. I mean, she's a lawbreaker. She's an adulterer. And so they, you know, if it was just up to the religious leaders, they would have dealt with her harshly, stoned her. I mean, that's what the law says. And Jesus knows this. And so they come to Jesus and they're like, you know, what do you say? They're trying to trap him. Look at verse 7. It says, they kept demanding an answer. So he stood up again and said, all right, but let the one who has never sinned throw the first stone. I mean, can you imagine what that moment right there would have been like? Anybody have any thoughts on what that might have been like at that, you know, just hearing Jesus say those words?
If I had my stone in my hand, you know, it would start to feel pretty heavy, I think.
Yeah.
It'd be like, I can't hold that anymore. I have no right to hold that stone.
Sure. I mean, you can almost imagine in that scene right there, you know, hearing the sound of some of the stones, you know, dropping from people's hands because they understood at that moment that they can't sit in the judgment seat of this woman because they all know that they've got something in her life or in their lives. And so instead of, you know, condemnation, instead of judgment, which is what she was expecting, probably what the crowd was expecting, and instead of all of that, Jesus does something else. He doesn't condone what she was doing. He doesn't condone the sinful lifestyle, but neither does he condemn her at that point. He looks at her and he does something that people really are not expecting. He doesn't say anything about her past. He doesn't say anything about any words of condemnation. Instead, he says something about himself. He makes this bold statement about himself. And this is in, verses 8 to 11. Then Jesus stood up and said again to the woman, where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them condemn you? No, Lord, she said. And Jesus said, neither do I. Go and sin no more. So again, no more condemnation. Not what anybody was expecting. And then he says this about himself. He says, Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. Now think about this. This woman is coming from a dark place in her life. I mean, who knows how long that she's been living this kind of a lifestyle. Who knows how many, you know, men that she might have been with. And she's just been caught in the act. She's, you know, been brought in from, you know, doing something very dark and living out a dark lifestyle, doing things that people only do in, you know, dark places. And so she's probably expecting this condemnation, but instead she gets compassion and forgiveness, and she gets this light, this light to show her this way out of the lifestyle that she's had. And so Jesus is basically looks at her and says, you know, your life doesn't have to be like this anymore. You can be released from your past and released from your sins and your regrets and your lifestyle. This is a way out. Why? Because I am the light of the world. And he says, for those who believe in him, for those who follow him, because follow and believe were really kind of the same thing. For those who follow him, they will never have to walk another day in darkness. I mean, what a moment, you know, right there where she is getting something that she is totally not expecting. And then, of course, as expected, the Pharisees are going to take issue with what Jesus is saying because he's making a bold claim about himself and also the forgiveness that he can offer her. It's based on who he is. So listen to what they say starting in verse 13. It says, the Pharisees replied, you are making those claims about yourself, and such testimony is not valid. Jesus told them, these claims are valid, even though I make them about myself, for I know where I came from and where I'm going. But if you don't know this about me, you judge me by human standards, but I do not judge anyone. And if I did, my judgment would be correct in every respect because I am not alone. The Father who sent me is with me. You see, the Pharisees, they're just all hung up on the claims that Jesus is making about himself. They're hung up on the fact that Jesus is saying that he is one with the Father, that he is the Son of God, and that he's making this claim that God is his Father, and they're also really missing the point of why Jesus came. And because of that, they're the ones who are really in the dark. I mean, they're the religious leaders of that time, and they were kind of perceived themselves to be the light of Israel and be able to illuminate the law of God so that everyone else can understand it. But Jesus is looking at them and saying, you guys are really the ones who are in the dark because they're missing the point of who he is and why he came. And the reason why he came is to bring the light. The light that could bring people, the only light that could bring people out of the darkness of their past, their mistakes, their sins, their lifestyles. But according to Jesus, this woman who had been living this very dark lifestyle, she's actually in better shape than the religious leaders who looked all religious and everything. They had the appearance of doing the right thing, but Jesus is looking at this woman, and you notice in this story how he's not focused on her behavior. I mean, if you notice, like, he didn't really say too much about it. And, you know, he knows who she is. He knows what she's done. But he chooses not to focus on that. Probably because he knows that she knows full well what she's been doing is wrong. Yeah. Instead, where does his focus go? His focus goes to the unbelief of the religious leaders. Because until that changes, and until they kind of come around to who he is, then there's not going to be any light. There's not going to be any life. There's not going to be any way to be right with God. And I mean, that's, you know, to us, I mean, that kind of sounds harsh, but I mean, he's being as truthful and as honest as he needed to be. He's being as truthful and honest as he would be if he were sitting here talking with us and helping us to understand the most important thing that we need to know and believe is that he is the Son of God, and that as the light of the world, that he has the light that also can release us from our past as well. But he really wants these religious leaders to understand how far off base they are and how much that they are still in the darkness. In fact, listen to what he says in verse 21. He says, later Jesus said to them again, I'm going away and you will search for me, but you will die in your sin. You cannot come where I'm going. You see, their unbelief would keep them in the dark. But for that woman, Jesus was the light at the end of a very long tunnel in her life. Because up to that point, she thought she knew what she needed. I mean, just like I talked about at the very beginning, a lot of times we think we know what we need. And she's lived her whole life thinking about, you know, what she thought she really needed in her heart of hearts and trying to find that love and acceptance and possibly significance. And she's looking for those things in all the wrong places. And obviously she's not finding it. But here's a beautiful thing about the story. She didn't have to change her behavior to come into the light of Jesus. She didn't have to conform to a set of laws or codes in order to be accepted by Jesus. All she had to do was to believe in Jesus. And that's what made her right. And you know, she found what she really did need. She found what all of us really need. And that's that unconditional love and mercy that can only come from him. And see, the light does two things. The light sometimes will expose and point out our glaring weaknesses and our sins. But in this case, the light did that. But in this case, the light also exposed her to the light of Christ and to his grace, the grace of God, which is just matchless and unending. And she understands that, you know, she no longer has to live that life anymore. That she can go from that place and that she can move on. And we need to understand, when it comes to being right with God, it all comes down to what we believe about his son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus told this woman, go and sin no more. In other words, he's telling her, you go from this place because of what you believe about me. And you walk in the light from this point forward. Because she could. Because she believed. And for those who are ready to leave a life of darkness, for those who are ready to leave a life of past sins and regrets, for those who are ready that they know that they need something different, that they're ready for something different, this is that opportunity to leave everything else behind. And the best part is, if Jesus isn't hung up on our past, then we don't need to be. If he wasn't hung up on this woman's past, but just told her, said, you can go and you can leave this place, that means that this is possible. This is possible too. And the only thing, this is so important to understand this, the only thing that is keeping us in the dark is our own belief. There's our own disbelief in Jesus' power to change our life. Because it's only a belief in him that can serve as the pathway toward the change that we're looking for. And you can experience that right now. You can be right with God right now. And when we realize that Jesus is the light, when we realize that he knows us, he knows everything about us, that he knows all of our sins, and yet he still chooses to love us, he still chose to come down and to die for us so that we can experience to give forgiveness, then we will want to walk in his light. And the motivation is not going to come from getting all of our act together and cleaning up and behaving. The motivation is not going to come from a set of laws. The motivation is going to come from his love. And that's always the way it was supposed to be. And that's really what we see from this story. So the question is, what should a person do with that? I mean, if you're thinking about the person that would come from a point of just, I don't think I'm ever going to be good enough. You know, I don't think I'm ever going to measure up to God's standard of morality and rightness and goodness. And I just don't think I'm the kind of person that's ever going to be able to walk in the light, you know. This story about Jesus being the light of the world brings so much hope. And so, you know, maybe you're listening to this for the first time and you know, you've never made a decision to trust Jesus with your entire life. I can't think of a better time. And, you know, maybe you're that person that's thinking, well, I have to get my act together first, and I have to become a better moral person first. And if you're thinking that, man, that's a mistake. That's incorrect thinking, because that's not what needs to happen. All you have to do is to believe in who Jesus is. And if you want to believe that, and you believe that Jesus can change a life, that he can transform us, then my hope is that you would somehow get in contact with us. You can go to our website, and you go all the way down to the bottom of our website, and there's a place where it says contact us, and you can send us a message, and we will reach out to you and talk to you about maybe a first-time decision to trust Jesus as the light and life to lead you to a new day, and you'll never have to walk another day in darkness. Now that's for someone that's never made a decision before, but you know, there's also several people that may have already made that decision, you know, maybe recently or maybe several years ago. And so the question becomes, how do I remain in the light? Because as Jesus told the woman, go and sin no more, which to me that means he's saying, you know, you've got this choice. You can go back to the life before, and you can walk in darkness, and you can choose that kind of behavior. Or because of who I am, I'm giving you the ability, I'm releasing you from that life, and you have a choice from this point forward to walk with me, follow me in the light. And so, you know, the question is, every day then, are we bringing our entire day into the light of Christ? Are we allowing his light to influence our entire day, or just part of the day? Are we bringing all of our decisions into the light of Christ, or just the easier one, just the parts that are, you know, easier to give to God. And maybe our relationships. So we're going to bring all of our relationships into the area where Jesus can shed light on all of our relationships, or is it just some of them? And again, that's a choice that each of us need to make on a daily basis to remain with him, to follow him, and to understand when we make that choice, he will empower us to do that because he has set us free from our past. And then the last thing that I would just encourage, you know, all of us to embrace is the fact that it's our responsibility to go out and to share the light. You know, what are you doing, especially during this time with the pandemic and still all the restrictions that we're under? There are still meaningful ways that we can reach out and share and show the light and the love of Christ to our neighbors. It may be something as simple as a phone call or a card, an encouraging note. When you can't safely, being able to take a meal to someone that needs that, or maybe provide childcare for someone that still needs to go into their job, as long as everybody is remaining safe. But there are ways to do that. And the beautiful part is, as we kind of envision what Jesus always had in mind, is that when more people are walking in the light and we get together, then we become that city on a hill. And you know, this is a dark world, and we need that kind of light right now in this world to point others toward Christ. And so that is my encouragement, that we would really desire each and every day to walk in the light of Christ. I'm going to have a word of prayer for us. And then, again, if you want to contact us in any way, we would love to talk with you. We'd love to encourage you. We are praying for you. We are confident we're all going to get through this, but we want to glorify God in the process. So let me pray for us. Father, we are so thankful for the love that you show us, the unconditional love and grace that we have in Jesus. And we are thankful that you have first called us to believe before you've called us to change our behavior. In fact, we know that it's you coming into our life and shining light into our life and becoming our life. And that's when you come in and you do the heavy lifting, and you're the one that brings the transformation. And we are so thankful that you have released us from our past. And really all we need to do is to focus on what we believe about your son, Jesus. We're thankful for his life. We're thankful for his light. We're thankful for his love. And we pray that you would give us ways to share it, that you would make us aware of the world around us that desperately needs to know the love and the light of Christ. We pray this in Jesus' powerful name.